I'd like to talk precisely about that notion of leadership. What does it mean to be a leader? What does it mean to be a follower? When you press the follow button on Instagram, on Facebook. But when you do that, when you press the button follow, what sort of leader do you want to follow? And I thought there's no better passage in the Old Testament, and probably in the whole Bible, which indicates how does a leader behave, than 1 Samuel 17, beautiful, powerful, and perennial story of the encounter between David and Goliath. The story shows us a nation, a country, who had a fake leader, a pseudo leader. Saul, that was his name, was someone who would not want to get involved. Saul was someone who would be afraid to enter the battle, to even face the image, the visage of the enemy. And we know that that nation called Israel had a very strong enemy in the people of the Philistines. But really, the story is about teenagers. Saul was not able to take a decision. He was weak, he was lacking will, he was confused. And of course, I'd like to put it to you that we live in a world in which confusion is deliberately stirred in your heart. Confusion about who you are, confusion about your faith, confusion about your nationality, confusion about your sexuality. If I'm not mistaken, since I've spent a few days in California, I realize that's quite an issue. So that confusion has been instilled in your heart by the Goliath, by someone who wants you to be weak, easily defeated, lacking conviction, lacking purpose. We like to do that navel gazing, we like to practice that form of narcissism that's so widespread in the social media. We like to take selfies rather than to face the enemy. But the problem with us when we do that is that we might end up in chains. Your ancestors, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the soldiers of George Washington, those who fought the battle for freedom in 1776, they knew that real leadership means courage, because they knew the story of David. There's an individual who is marginal, and he is the most important one. The one who was a shepherd. Do we pay attention to this ironic situation in our lives? That someone who is there in the unseen part of our life might have something to teach us? Or are we those who judge people according to their external physical appearance? So this is the moment when David feels he's got to do something, because the nation is living in fear. Just like many people today in California, in the United States, in Europe, in Western Europe and Eastern Europe, have this fear, live in the grip of anxiety, because they might be labeled, because they might be branded, because they might be ridiculed, mocked, only because they are who they are. And sometimes, when the nation, when the family, when the church lives in the grip of fear, it's quite necessary for an individual to step up, to come up in front of the crowd, and to show the way. And this is David. But before he is doing that, he is making sure that he is a son of a wise father. In the Living Bible, when David left the sheep with another shepherd and took off early the next morning with the gifts that he had to give to those who were supposed to fight, and the gifts were bushel of roasted grain and 10 loaves of bread. So here is an interesting situation. The father is telling the son to do something rather humble, a humble work, and the son is very eager to do that, to perform that task of obedience. Before he steps into the big battle, he is doing the humble, the modest work. Of course, he is very preoccupied, David, with the situation of his people. He goes and he's asking them, how do they feel? He's talking to them, he says, and this is another sign of true leadership. A true leader cares for his people. A true leader is among his people. He's not aloof. He's not watching them from distance. He is shaking hands. He's able to look him or her into the eyes and say, hello, how are you today? How are you doing? Are you feeling good? Are you prepared? Do you need something? Do you need some loaves of bread? Do you need some food? Do you need some clothing? That's what a real leader does. He is among his people. He is not watching them from distance. He is not arrogant. He is not necessarily thinking that he's above. He is in the midst of those who are in need. That's the mark of Christian leadership. And whether we are in a family, whether we are in a church, whether we do a teamwork in our school, or perhaps we have a calling in our city, in our community, or in our nation, we've got to have that specific mark of leadership, which means a caring love for the other. Of course, the story is very complex, and I don't think I've got enough time to tell you all the nuances and meanings encrypted in the text. But as you know the story, David is insisting that he should be the one who will fight Goliath, while, of course, his brothers are envious, while many other soldiers think this is crazy because he apparently has no preparation. And of course, he's not paying attention to those who want to diminish him. He's not paying attention to those who want to prevent him from the battle. Just like Peter wanted to prevent Jesus from entering the last battle, the battle on the cross. And when Peter said to Jesus that he should avoid the cross, Jesus said to him, in Latin, retro satana, back off, Satan. And he was Peter. It's pretty strong words, right, from Jesus in that specific situation. So maybe sometimes in our lives we are in a position when those who are our relatives and our friends and our fellow travelers and citizens and classmates, they are those who tell you, don't go for this fight, it's not for you, it's too much, who do you think you are? Because we want not to think big most of the time. We want to think always in small measures. We want to diminish our calling because it's cheaper, because it's easier, because it's more comfortable, and because that way we will not confront the unknown, we will not confront our fears, we will not confront Goliath. So finally, David is able to face the beast. David is able to look Goliath into his eyes. And of course, he's very much aware that in this battle, he is not representing himself. In this battle, he is not willing to prove that he has a good name. Though it's not bad to have a good name. But that's not the point. He's not trying to get social capital by what he's doing. He's not trying to win votes, by the way. He is there with a specific calling. And he says, David shouted in reply, "You come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of the armies of heaven and of Israel, the very God whom you have defied today, not tomorrow." That's how a leader speaks. Today, not tomorrow. Today, the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head, and I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and wild animals and of the whole world, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And Israel will learn that the Lord does not depend on weapons to fulfill his plans. He works without regard to human means.